You're listening to the Hour of the Time. I'm William Cooper. Ladies and gentlemen, tonight, after I get through with a few things that have to be taken care of here, we're going to open the phones and see what's on your mind. So, be thinking about what you'd like to say. Saturday, February the 4th. Saturday, February the 4th at 11 a.m. in front of State Sales Tax Office, 2024 3rd Avenue, North Birmingham, Alabama. There will be a tax protest. It says, come share our grief. Protest state and federal abuses of citizens' liberties. Southern Patriots invited. That's Saturday, February the 4th at 11 a.m. in front of State Sales Tax Office, 2024 3rd Avenue, North Birmingham, Alabama. It's organized by Steve Stowe, Southern Flag and Novelty. If you want information, you can call him at the store at area code 205-699-4712. That's 205-699-4712, or at his home, 205-640-1954. It's 205-640-1954. Also in February the 18th, there are two meetings of the Constitution Party, and I don't have the other one with me, so I'll try to get that for you tomorrow night, but the one I have here is the Constitution Party meeting for Ohio. Will be in Columbus, Ohio on February the 18th, Route 161 and 71 at the Comfort Inn. I don't have the time for that. Whoever's doing this, please fax me the time tomorrow so that I can make the proper announcement tomorrow night. And a phone number where somebody can contact the people are putting this together. Please do that for me so that people will know who to call and so they'll know what time to be there. Now, we've got some new addresses for you. The Constitution Party. The address for the Constitution Party is now Post Office Box 2009. That's P.O. Box 2009, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. That's St. John's, Arizona, 85936. Once again, the new address for the Constitution Party is the Constitution Party, Post Office Box 2009, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. The address for the center here and for the intelligence analyst is Post Office Box 3390. That's the intelligence service or the intelligence analyst. Post Office Box 3390, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. One more time. The intelligence service or the intelligence analyst, if you're writing to the newspaper, Post Office Box 3390, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. If you're going to order the intelligence analyst, it's $50 a year. Will be published bi-monthly. That's once every 2 weeks. I know they said Friday night it was bi-weekly. It's not. Bi-monthly. $50 a year. Will be published bi-monthly. If we can, we'll get it down to weekly. I don't know if we'll be able to do that, but we'll try. And the deadline for the first issue is March 1st, 1995. We hope to be able to get the first issue out before that, and we've got plenty of time to do it. And then we'll be every 2 weeks after that first issue. So if you'd like to be a charter subscriber, send $50 for your first year's subscription to the Intelligence Analyst, Post Office Box 3390, St. John's, Arizona, 85936. Also, sometime during the first week in February, and I don't know exactly when that's going to be, we're going to switch satellites. We're going to be switching to T2. That's T2, satellite T2, transponder 21, also known as channel 21, 5.8 wideband audio. That's satellite T2, transponder or channel, whichever one you're used to calling it, 21. And you have to manually adjust to 5.8 wideband audio. So those are the announcements for tonight, ladies and gentlemen. And right after the little break here, I'm going to come back and got some more things we got to handle, and then we're going to go to the phones. So, folks, don't go away. Somewhere here, I might know what I'm doing. I've been down for a few days, in case you didn't figure that out, but I'm back.
Come on, let's cruise, you got nothing to lose. Come on, let's cruise, you got nothing to lose. Come on, let's cruise, you got nothing to lose. Come on, hey, baby, come on. Come on, let's cruise, you got nothing to lose. Come on, let's cruise, you got nothing to lose. Come on.
That's right, folks. Stick with me tonight. You got nothing to lose, nothing else to do. Super Bowl's over. Got a letter here to read, and got to address this because it begs to be addressed. It's from the Euro-American Alliance, from Major Donald V. Clerken, Chairman / Commander. And he says, "Dear Mr. Cooper, though I admire your courage against the power of the ADL, your attempts to disparage me constitute an expression of personal spleen. I see the Jews the way they see themselves, as a tribe, a collective. Not every Jew in the world is involved in the planned destruction of Western Christian civilization, the Aryan race, and its culture. The Jews who do not involve themselves watch passively as their landsmen pick away at the thing they hate most as a people. If their rabbis demand money to fuel the ADL, AI PAC, etc., the nice Jews kick in. Only a few Jews in the history of this world have had the guts to say no to the destruction of Christianity and its faithful. the white race. The Benjamin Friedmans, the Myron Fagans are all there is. Your animus towards me is directed at my position on race. I see the threat aimed at the Aryan people and their ways. There is no ideology in this. Oswald Spengler detailed the historical end of an epoch by identifying ideology as the keynote. Nothing speaks to you from the blood any longer. For you, it is either on paper or it isn't there. You are no different from Robert Flancher, district attorney of Racine County, Wisconsin, who said to the court and to me on January 6, 1995, quote, "The law does not require me to hold a John Doe. I don't want to hold one, and I won't," end quote. This was in response to a mandamus I filed against him to force him to subpoena witnesses in a murder case of a skinhead killed in Racine by a black. I don't hate you because you married a Chinese woman. I don't approve of interracial marriages. But if you want approval, you have the family you've made for yourself. My approval isn't necessary, but I reserve the right to instruct the Aryan people against doing what you have done. Whites are the only real minority in this world. Sincerely, Donald V. Clerken, Major Chairman / Commander. Says, P.S., the new governance after the collapse will be a lot more careful of its social relationships. Now, that little P.S. there is really the problem that I have with you, Major Clerken, and all other racists. I don't care what race you belong to, whether it's black, oriental, white. I don't care what you call yourself, period. You see, you put this stuff in this letter like you're not involved in anything, and then you make a veiled threat in the P.S. And by the way, I haven't been disparaging you. I made a little comment the last night I was on when I was answering another letter. It wasn't the last night, but when I answered another letter, accusing all the Jews of being involved in a plot. It's total crap. Not all of anybody is ever involved in anything. You see, the same kind of logic would apply to the white race in lieu of your belief. It's just as wrong to say all whites are Aryan supremacists as it is to say all Jews are out to get all whites. It just isn't true, nor are all blacks or anybody else. The bone I have to pick with you is shortly after I began broadcasting, I used to get all this stream of mail from all the racists who, for some reason or other, had the mistaken opinion that I was one of them. I've never been a racist in my life. I will never be a racist in my life. Racism, as far as I'm concerned, is the greatest plague ever visited upon mankind. And all this hate mail and all this stuff that was just dripping with venom and all kinds of plans that do away with the other races and everything. And when you all found out that I wasn't one of you, then I got all this hate mail directed at me, how I should be wiped out. And you, Major Clerken, and your friend there, I forget what his name is, wrote me some of the most horrible letters I've ever received in my life. Blatant attacks upon my wife and my daughter. And, Mister, I will never forgive you for that, although I respect your right to hold whatever opinion you have and to voice whatever beliefs you wish, and will protect those rights with my own life if I have to. I will not stand for your personal attacks upon me or my family. Period. Never. Not in a million years. For I happen to know for a fact that no matter what you say, or what kind of wonderful rhetoric you cloak your real intentions in, the truth is, this P.S. at the end of your letter is exactly what you want. The new governance, after the collapse, will be a lot more careful in its social relationships. You see, I know exactly what that means. I know that if people like you ever came to power, Major Clerken, you would kill anybody in this world that doesn't look like you, or doesn't agree with you, or that you don't like. That's the truth of the matter. And folks, for those of you that understand where all this stuff comes from, don't miss tomorrow night and the night after. I'm going to show you where it comes from. I'm going to educate you a little bit into the teachings of Plato, a man named Kant, and another man named Hegel. And then I'm going to read to you directly out of the writings of the secret societies who create these racist thoughts in people and manipulate them. For Major Clerken, you are being manipulated. You're just a puppet being used. You see, what difference does it make to you who I or anyone else marries? Why should you even care? Everybody in this world should be able to live as they wish and be happy as long as they do not injure the person or property of any other person. And that's the truth. All this stuff is meant to divide us and make us fight each other so that we can all be eventually enslaved by one side or another in this conflict. Basically, there's four major players who constitute two sides. And it doesn't matter which one is going to win. Communism is just as bad as fascism. And those are your two choices, folks. And if you're listening tomorrow night and the night after, you're going to discover that without any doubt whatsoever. And believe me, there should be only one goal in this world for everyone. That's how can we mature as individuals and stop finding reasons to kill or burn at the stake or persecute other people and just be happy in this world. And I'm a great student of human nature. I know that that's going to be impossible because of people like Major Clerken and because of people in the black race who claim that all of their problems are because of whitey, or because of the Jews who want to stay segregated in their ghettos and lash out at the world because somebody killed a Jew 100 years ago, or some Jews were killed in World War II. Are the American Indians because they were beat in the battle for the continent? Are the whites because they think that their gene pool is at stake? Major Clerken, nobody's forcing you to marry outside your race. Or any other white so-called Aryan person. Why do you feel so threatened? All you have to do is find a blonde-haired, blue-eyed babe and go to bed with her. I hope you marry her first. Have some kids. Your race won't be in danger. But you seem to think that somebody's going to force you in bed with somebody that you don't want to be in bed with. And I got to tell you something else. My daughter, who is part American Indian, Chinese, Scotch, English, and Irish, will stand up in intelligence and beat any blonde-haired, blue-eyed babe that you can bring along. I can guarantee it. With no doubts whatsoever. Not because she's exceptional or has a bigger brain or anything else, but because I began to teach her shortly after she was born to use her brain. And all the studies that I've ever seen on mixed race children, including the children who were left in Vietnam by American fathers who had a night on the town with one too many and did the thing that most soldiers do, the studies say that these children, on the average, are more intelligent, more able to survive, extremely streetwise, and do much better in school. And Mr. Clerken, if your assertion that the white race is so much better than all the other races, how do you account for the higher test scores and the higher academic achievements of Oriental children in school? In the same schools that all of your Aryan children attend? You can't answer that question because you're full of crap. You have been all your life with this racist stuff, and you will be all the rest of your life if you don't wise up. Because by all the ways to measure it, almost everybody's inferior to the Oriental race. The truth is, nobody's inferior to anyone. The truth is, people perform, people learn according to the cultural values that they are taught and the morals that their parents impart to them. And people also tend to live up to what is expected of them. In Oriental countries, they're expected not to just make it, but to excel. And so they do. And I could go on and on and on, because that's not the only people who do, nor the only area. And I have a feeling I'm wasting my breath on people like you anyway. You will hate and you will scheme and you will plot for your white Aryan nation. And if you get the power to do so, heaven help anybody who doesn't look like you, or smell like you, or talk like you, or comb their hair like you, or have the same color skin that you have. Some viruses are more friendly. I had a fax, ladies and gentlemen, from a Mr. Miller, who says, subject, follow up to an earlier fax message. I forgot to mention that during Clinton's speech that I heard the word New Covenant repeated approximately 8 times. On my local ABC newscast, after the president's speech, a congresswoman from Georgia's 11th District, C. McKinney, repeated, quote, "We have made a new covenant with the American people, and we are trying to see where we fit into the new world order." End quote. The television station is WJBF, Augusta, Georgia. Time aired was approximately 11:15 in the evening. And this fax is dated the 25th of January. So I don't know if this was sent the day after or the same night that that aired. But you should be able to find out from the television station. And finally, after this, we'll go to the phones. This is from the New York Times, ladies and gentlemen. You say that there isn't something happening. You say that there's not world government coming. Well, listen to this. This is from the New York Times, April the 15th, 1994. New York Times, April 15th, 1994. Pages A19 and A20. And it says, 1944, Bretton Woods, the International Monetary Fund and the World Bank. 1945, San Francisco, the United Nations. 1994, Marrakesh, the World Trade Organization. History knows where it's going. It's in Morocco that 124 counties or countries are signing the GATT agreement. For the first time, a treaty that will do much to shape the world's future will bear the name of Marrakesh, a city at once Arab and African. The final act of the Uruguay round, marking the conclusion of the most ambitious trade negotiation of our century, will give birth in Morocco to the World Trade Organization, the third pillar of the New World Order, along with the United Nations and the International Monetary Fund. The fact that this treaty, surely one of the most important in the history of nations, is signed in Marrakesh testifies to the esteem and trust in which the international community holds Morocco. Today, as yesterday, it is in Morocco that the hopes and ambitions of the nations of the North and the South converge. None was as qualified as Morocco to be at this crossroads of opportunity and hope. This ad, ladies and gentlemen, was paid for by the government of Morocco. Morocco knows what's happening. How come nobody else does? Good evening. You're on the air.
Yes, Bill.
Yes.
Been listening for a while. You've been having open phones up for a while. I would like for you to think about something, and I know you like to do your own research, and therefore, you know, I'm inviting you to do some research. I've done it myself. Using the Patriots movement as a modern day example, to look back at the Confederacy and why the South felt it necessary to separate itself from the rest of the United States, and why they eventually lost. You know, I think that those are, you know, and it's not the old stuff that was taught to people in high school.
Oh, I know that.
Yeah, and I think it's something that I think it's something to be found as far as information goes in doing this. The suggestion that I would make is to read at least 20 books. And if you want to, read books that are printed after 1965, but don't count those as part of the 20. Because there's been a lot of garbage printed since about 1965.
Absolutely.
And I would suggest Canton and Foote, Shelby Foote, to make up 6 of the books. Each one of them has 3 volumes.
Mm-hmm.
And, for anybody else out there, because it would take way too long, I think, for me to give my ideas. And then they would only be my ideas. So people could, you know, get their own ideas. And eventually, you know, it comes down to it. What you're doing now is the right thing. You know, it's what should be done. But whenever the takeover comes or whatever, I would wish for you to you know, look at, you know, the South and the hopeless cause. You know, the hopeless cause has a lot of followers. You know, witness those people who revel in the Alamo, the Spartans of Thermopylae. You know, it's Custer. I'm a Custer fan myself. And yet, I don't think that is necessary to die in a hopeless cause.
And why do you think it's hopeless?
Well, for the same reasons why the South loses the Civil War, just at one or two, and that is that, the South can be said to have died of democracy. People in the South were not able to handle the amount of freedom that the potential that was there for them to receive from the secession. I'm afraid that's basically true, that the American people in general are just not capable of handling the amount of freedom that may come their way. And if they will reject those people who are fighting for their own personal freedom.
It's not that they can't handle freedom. It's that they don't want to give up the socialist welfare check, whether it's a retirement check or whether it's Medicaid or what it happens to be called. That's really what they don't want to give up.
Well, that is certainly part of it, but there's also the bigger, there's an overshadowing thing. I think there are many people in this country that take pride and being a member of a country that's the biggest bully on the block. And I think that is what they're going to have to give up also, which is that the power. They're going to have to individually give up the power of telling other people in the world what to do and feeling superior to everybody else in the world. You know, that was the Iraqi thing. That's what sold it to the American people, was their ability to tell other countries what to do. Not the truth. There's a lot of other truth going on in Iraq.
No, you bought the propaganda. You see, most Americans did not approve of the Gulf War, but they were afraid of being called traitors if they didn't pretend like they were for it.
Yes.
Those polls that said that 94% of the American people were solidly behind the Gulf War and George Bush were lies.
Of course they were.
All over this country, there were huge demonstrations in every major city in this country that were never shown on television.
Well, and they didn't interview many Vietnam veterans either.
Well, that's true.
We could have told them.
So, that's just not true. America as a whole was not for the war in the Gulf. Most people couldn't spell Iraq, much less find it on a map. And nobody ever heard of Kuwait in their whole life.
But not enough people were moved to do something about it. I really do think that there's a certain amount of cherishing being the bully. I really think that people, if they had to choose between certain freedoms and having 150 cable access, TV, they would choose the cable TV.
Well, I think you're right. I got to take a break.
Okay, but would you do it? Look into the.
I got to take a break.
Bye.
Bye. Ladies and gentlemen, the hour of the time is brought to you by Swiss America's Trading. The only people that I know that do such a good job at what they do that it's the only ones that we could allow to sponsor this broadcast in that particular field. And they're the only ones that I feel comfortable enough and have gotten to know enough that I can back them also. For they have given me their word that they will treat the listeners to this broadcast with VIP treatment, and that they will make sure that there's no double dealing or any kind of questionable or shady transactions going on with any of their people. And I've come to know Craig Smith and Gene Miller, Joanne, a lot of people down there so well over the past, it's been over 2 years now, that we've become very good friends. And they're the only ones that I know that guarantee what they do. They're the only ones I know of have a buyback policy. Do you know anybody else has a buyback policy? Do you know anybody else that not only is backed by the company you're doing business with, but by the man who advertised it? For I've given you my word that if Swiss America Trading ever cheats anybody, and I know that they never would, and that's why I can say this, but if it ever happened, I'd be down there so quick, folks, right in their face. And I'd make sure that it was made good really quick. Most problems always result from just simple misunderstandings. Knowing that, they record the terms of every agreement on every sale of precious metals that they do. Not only that, but before your order is even shipped out, after they get your bank draft, or your check and it clears, or money order, or however you do your business, the people in the shipping department call you and go over the exact terms of the agreement again, and it's taped again. So there can be no misunderstandings. Nobody can say that anybody else said something that they didn't say. Nobody else can claim that something happened that they weren't aware of. It just can't happen with Swiss America Trading. I know. Because I've seen how that tape stuff works down there. And folks, I'm going to tell you this from my heart. You can't deal with better people. You just can't. You can't find them anywhere. Not in any kind of a sales business. These people really care about America. They care about you. They care about the message of this broadcast. And God knows that they've suffered a lot for some of the things that I've said on this broadcast, because people sometimes boycott businesses because of what they hear on a program where they're advertising. But on this broadcast, the hour of the time is synonymous with Swiss America trading. And the hour of the time is synonymous with them. If you're thinking about covering yourself against what is sure to come, and if you haven't been studying this derivatives market, then you're going to be in for the shock of your life. There's going to be a fall, folks. Whether they have to make it happen, or whether the derivatives bring it down, whatever, it's going to happen. It has to happen. Because part of the socialist goal for the New World Order is to eliminate the middle class. And that's the easiest, best way to do it. They also have to figure out some way to make the sheeple swallow a declaration of national emergency to bring this all about. And I can think of no better way than a financial collapse again. So call Swiss America Trading. Talk to them. If you have an idea, field it to them. See if they can help you with it. If you don't, if you've never done this before, ask them how it's done. What are the different ways? What are the best investments in their opinion? And then don't just believe them. You know, check for yourself. But don't call me. I'm not an investment advisor. So what I advise you to do is put at least some of your money into precious metals, because it's the only real money. And it's the only thing that never loses its value, no matter what happens. You'll be able to buy the same number of loaves of bread 10 years from now as you can today, as you could 100 years ago, with 1 ounce of gold or 1 ounce of silver. It's always been that way. And as long as people need something of substance, a commodity that they can feel is worth something, it's always going to be that way. I can assure you. So call them, 1-800-289-2646. 1-800-289-2646. And do it now, folks. Did dot did it, did dot did it, did it, did dot did it, did dot did it, did it, did dot did it, did dot did it, did it, did dot 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 did it, I'm begging, really, honey, honey, baby, I want to be. If I want to love, baby, I need your love. Honey, honey, come back home with me. If I want your love, can't live without your love. Honey, honey, come back home. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hello, Bill.
Yes.
Can you hear me through this line?
Yes, I can, Jeff. How are you doing?
Well, not so good. I sent you a letter on this situation, but I'll be brief. I tried to send your copies of Behold the Pale Horse to Recordings for the Blind to see if they could record them, and they returned them to me with a note saying that they were, quote, of limited political interest. I sent you a copy of that letter.
Uh-huh.
If you people in the audience know where these books are recorded in the form that a blind person can use, such as cassettes, etc., please let me know. My number is 504-525-4369. 504-525-4369. And let Bill Cooper know again, please, so we can get this information out. One other thing. The Republicans have done it again. They're trying to push the line item veto, which would make the president into a Roman emperor who could dictate to Congress what bills would be passed and what would not by virtue of his use of that power. And I've tried to warn people about this. Very briefly put, if the president can pick and choose what he wants in a bill, and if the Congress wants to fight him, he can make all kinds of deals. So we've got to stop that line item veto if we can.
Well, I agree with you. And I do know that my book has been recorded by someone who records on audio tape books for the blind. And I hope that someone gets in touch with you. If you can't get in touch with him or didn't get Jeffrey's number, please notify me, and I'll give out that information on the air tomorrow night.
Thank you.
Thank you, Jeffrey.
In touch.
Okay. 602-337-2524 is the number for any new listeners who may be out there who don't know. And by the way, for the rest of the 24 hours when we're not on the air using that for our calling line, it is our fax number. It is our fax number. While we're on the air and we're taking call-ins, it is our call-in number. 602-337-2524. Good evening. You're on the air.
20 years ago, I was banned from my homeland. I was classed as a madman, a charlatan, outlawed in the world of science, which previously honored me as a genius.
Well, whoever it was didn't have the guts to make his point or to finish it. And I wonder who the genius was. Was that you, Clerken, or was that one of your little Heil Hitler henchmen? 602-337-2524. If you're going to call in, at least have the guts to make a point. If you haven't got the guts, don't waste our time. We got better things to do. We're not full of hate here. We're trying to make this a better world. We're trying to solve what's coming peacefully. If we would just wake up enough people, there doesn't have to be one drop of bloodshed in this whole world, folks. And that's the truth. The real power lies always with the people. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hi, Bill. This is Michelle from Oklahoma calling, and I want to respond to Jeffrey. We have a 24-track recording studio in our home here and would be happy to record any materials that he would like recorded for listening on audio cassette.
Well, I think that's wonderful, but I don't think you have to do that. I know my book has already been recorded for one of these organizations that record books for the blind and is available to any blind person for free if they just request it. But the trouble is I don't remember which one it is because it was done so long ago, and all we need to do is find out.
Well, I'd be glad to do this for him if he can't locate other materials that he wants just to help somebody out.
Okay, Michelle. You've been helping us out an awful lot. And by the way, folks, Michelle does transcripts of the broadcasts and puts them on the BBS for anybody to download under the Hour of the Time conference file area. Did I say that right?
I think that's right. Anyway, if Jeffrey calls you back, you have my phone number, and if he'd like to contact me, you feel free to do that. I know there's an awful lot of good materials out there, and how can you pick which one, you know? So if he has something on his wish list that he'd like to contact me about, we can get him taken care of just because he's a good guy.
Great. Yeah, he is a good guy, and he's been pumping information in here for as long as I can remember.
He's had some real good comments on the phone, and I have a great deal of respect for him. So if he calls you back, just give him my phone number, and if he wants to call us, he sure can.
Okay.
Okay?
Thank you, Michelle.
Bye-bye.
God bless you, too. 602-337-2524 is the number. If you would like to make your mark on the world, you can say something brilliant and make everybody pause and think, and even keep everybody awake all night thinking about what you said, or you can say something absolutely miserably stupid, and but that's okay because nobody knows who you are. Nobody in this whole world knows who you are but you. Good evening. You're on the air.
Hello, Bill.
Yes.
Is Robert Anton Wilson part of the conspiracy?
Is he part of the conspiracy? I had no idea.
Well, is he pro-mystery school or anti-mystery school?
Well, I'd say he's pro-mystery school, being that he belongs to it.
Yeah, because I've read a few of his books, like, you know, the Cosmic Trigger series.
Let me tell you exactly what Robert Anton Wilson does. By the way, I spoke with him in Atlanta at a conference, and the man is extraordinary, to say the least. But he belongs to not one of the mystery schools, but as far as I'm able to pinpoint, at least two, the OTO and the Golden Dawn. And I believe sincerely that he writes these books as intellectual spoofs to ensure that that the concept of any kind of conspiracy or any kind of an effort to rule the world by a group of this brotherhood is ludicrous. And he does a very good job of it. In fact, I like to read his books, but also there are an awful lot of clues and tidbits in his books that I think he leaves there intentionally as kind of a joke to laugh at the sheeple. Only, he's beginning to find out that not all of us are sheeple, and some of us appreciate a good joke and follow it through.
Yes, I've always been sort of annoyed by his tongue-in-cheekness. I mean, why doesn't he just say straight out, what's what? I've read A.E. Wade and a lot of the Masonic histories that are verified by their own works, and he just seems to hide behind his tongue-in-cheekness. Also, was the documentation you were referring to that Jacques Vallée was involved at with the mystery schools or the OTO? He was involved with some of those secret groups.
Oh, yeah. Not only that, but there's a photograph of Jacques Vallée that he posed himself holding his hands in such a manner so that it forms a perfect triangle over one eye while the other eye is hidden, masked.
Wow. Where can I get a copy of that? Is that available anywhere on any of his books?
Well, I have a copy here, and I don't remember exactly where we found it, but we have a copy here, and if you look hard enough, you'll find it too, because, he was laughing at the world when he did that. And the first clue that I have that Jacques Vallée was involved in the mysteries, and specifically in the Grand Orient Lodge of France, was in one of Robert Anton Wilson's books.
Yeah, I was about to say that his attendance of a Crowley mass party.
That's right.
Was mentioned in Cosmic Trigger 1, where they're talking about the implications of UFOs and all of that.
That's correct, and that's what set me off in an investigation to find out just how deeply Jacques Vallée was involved, and we found out that he's up to his eyeballs.
Wow. I mean, I also know the history of, L. Ron Hubbard and Jack Parsons, who was one of the rocket scientists of the founders of the JPL.
Yes.
And also, I wanted to ask you also, I know you mentioned the Order of the Trapezoid in your book, but I haven't been able to find any more information to cross-reference that. Could you talk a little about that in detail?
Not tonight, and I don't have any plans to do it anytime soon.
Okay.
I do my shows according to lessons that I'm trying to teach people and get them to go out and look. But, I talked about that during the mystery series, and...
Okay. Yeah, I just heard that the Order of the Trapezoid was... something like the highest order in the Temple of Set, and they study the metaphysical implications of how certain ideas or notions get downloaded into human consciousness from a metaphysical source.
Yeah.
So Descartes had some kind of mystical experience when he was a young soldier of fortune, where he said that he was revealed the tenets of mathematics of how to harness the powers of nature by an angel that came to him when he was sitting by the fire as he was a young soldier of fortune out in the forest one night.
Mm-hmm.
And they said that what kind of forces in the world make an emperor like Constantine have a dream that he would win his battles if he had the cross and the dove on these shields of his battalions.
Well, you have to understand the symbology of that. The cross represents sacrifice, and the dove represents the soul. The soul, through sacrifice, becomes one with God. Anyone who becomes one with God is indefeatable. This is their belief. You see, they're fooling themselves.
Yeah. All right, Bill, I'll let you go. Thank you very much, and I'll call you again.
You're welcome.
Goodbye.
You see, folks, in the mysteries, their theology is never mind. It's all bunk, all of it. It's how you get the only secret when you get to the top is how the promise of a secret controls everybody who doesn't know what the secret is. And that's the truth of the whole matter. how they convince you that, well, you'll see tomorrow night and the night after, because a lot of things will be revealed to you tomorrow night and the night after. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hi, Bill. This is Tom. I'm calling from Indiana. And I have a question that I'm really trying to understand, and that is that, you know, you've got the Constitution Party, and we're making an effort there to politically try to straighten things out, but at the same time we're, you know, preparing through the militias to have to fight. And my question is, do you feel as though the Constitution Party is going to be able to make a difference before the time runs out till it gets to the point where we have to fight? I mean, is the Constitution Party more of a long-range organization that maybe will pick up the pieces after the war is fought, or just how do you see it all fitting together?
There's not going to be nothing left after the war is fought but total confusion and anarchy and ashes, probably. It doesn't matter. You see, we have to do whatever we can to prevent bloodshed as responsible human beings. That is what I'm about with the Constitution Party. And if we all wake up and do enough of our own individual parts in this, there doesn't have to be any bloodshed. Do you understand that?
Yeah, I can. I guess the thing that's confusing me in my mind is whether or not the momentum is going to be reached to where there's enough people that are awake that it will work.
Well, you can't go by that. You have to do everything you can to try to make that happen, not sit back and say, well, am I going to get involved in this because, you know, maybe it's not going to work or whatever. We have to make it work. And if it doesn't work, then we have to be able to fall back on what was given to us by our founding fathers.
Okay, well, yeah, that makes sense, and I don't disagree. I guess, you know, I just needed you to kind of explain it to me, because I still am kind of new to all this. And,
well, that's okay. I was new to it once, too.
Yeah. All right, well, I appreciate your help.
Thank you for calling.
Thank you.
Yeah, folks, we have to do everything within our power to be as responsible as we can to stop the loss of our liberty and the protection of our individual rights through peaceful means. And if we can't, if they force it upon us, and believe me, it'll have to be forced upon me, but if they force it upon me for the sake of my children, I will have to fight them. Good evening, you're on the air.
Good evening, Bill. This is Jim from Oroville, California.
Hello, Jim.
I hope my question isn't too trivial, but regarding the strange markings on the backsides of signs on the highways,
freeways,
the question was bandied about why are they on the backside, which brought up the next question, is it perhaps for the benefit of foreign drivers trained to drive on the left side of the road, which would make them visible if they were driving on the left side?
Well, nobody drives on the left side of the road here.
Not here.
And they're here.
Blue helmet type people.
Well, you shouldn't speak in riddles. And, you know, I was trying to take you seriously there. But
No. I mean, if you have, say, the situation degrades to the point where we have foreign troops here.
Well, we already have foreign troops here.
Yeah, but suppose they are pressed into service, supposedly because of the dilution of our armed forces.
If they try to overtly
right.
take away the freedoms of the American people
right.
and claim a world government, they will have to, because the military forces of the United States aren't big enough to do it. And I'm going to tell you, they can bring all the foreign troops they want to this country. This country is too big, and Americans are too smart, and they love freedom too much to allow it to happen.
Glad to hear that.
It'll be one hell of a fight. I can't tell you who will win, but if they try it.
All right. Well, I'll be in there with you.
Yeah, good.
And best regards to your family.
Thank you.
Bye.
Well, so I'm going to say this again. I'm doing all I can, and I hope you are too, to make sure that it never comes to that. But if it does, I hope that you're smart enough to be ready for it. We had a caller earlier who thought that it was losing battle. You know, when the alternative is slavery, it's not a losing battle. Because I don't want to be a slave under any conditions. I'll die fighting for my liberties, and I don't know about you, if it comes to that. Good evening, you're on the air.
Hi, Bill.
Hello.
I just have a simple question about the militias. How many, in your estimation, are there in this country? Individuals?
Individuals?
Yeah, you know, collectively.
If I knew, I wouldn't tell you.
You wouldn't tell me?
No.
Because when I was watching the Donahue show, one of the members on the stage said...
Those guys there don't know either.
They have no idea.
No. I will tell you this. It's a lot more than anybody thinks in their wildest dreams. But as to exact numbers, I don't know. And I don't think anybody really knows. And I don't think anybody's really going to know, because a lot of these militias are formed and organized and trained in secret and don't tell anybody who they are. And if I knew, I would not tell you or anyone else.
I suspect there's a lot of people like myself who aren't a part of a militia, but are preparing and, you know, to enter one should the time come.
Well, good.
All right?
Mm-hmm.
Have a nice evening.
You too.
Bye.
Good night. Well, folks, that about does it. I hope, I pray, in fact, every night, that all of us can mature, can grow up, can learn that there is a common denominator for all of us, and that common denominator is liberty. If all of you listening, and all of those not listening, and everybody in here sitting in this center listening live to this broadcast, can learn to respect everyone else's freedom and leave them alone. Whatever they're doing, it's none of your business. It's none of my business. It's none of anybody's business. Just leave people alone. Let them be happy in whatever way they want to be happy. Leave them alone. Our freedom should be such that as long as we're not injuring the person or property of any other person, we should be left alone. There are too many people trying to tell too many other people what to do and how to do it and when to do it. There are people in this world that if they could, would be in your bedroom watching every little thing that you did. And I know there's not one single person out there listening who wants that to happen, no matter what you are or what you believe in. Good night, folks. God bless you all. God save the Republic.
Your heart to me.